All right. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us. DNA Behavior presentation of Navigating Your Financial Behavior, Understanding and Managing Client Couples. My name is Tripp Rockwell. I'm the Chief Marketing Officer here, joined with Lan Morales, our newly minted Managing Director here, a bump up from being our Chief Relationship Officer. So thank you for that. We'll have to get that updated on your resume there. But a few quick housekeeping points before moving forward. One, we hope to only take up about a half hour, 35 minutes of your time with our presentation. We'll certainly stop and answer questions as they're posted. And to that note, we leave the question and chat box open. I'll be managing that throughout the presentation as they come up, and happy to share anything that's worthwhile along the way. We'll also have a number of poll questions to help ensure that everyone's keeping up with the material. It is a quick overview, so to speak, of the educational products and services that we provide. But you never know what questions come up along the way. And it is part three of a three-part series. Not that you have to have followed all along the whole way, but there are some things we're going to skim through pretty quickly here on the front end in order to get to the meat of the couples a couples-based program that we're in for today. That being said, the audio is shut down for everyone so that there's not a lot of cross-chatter. Again, using the Q&A and chat buttons, we'll be monitoring those. And then the poll questions that we'll be answering along the way, also followed by a survey. And we really encourage everyone, as part of the survey, give us that feedback there. We encourage you to take your own profile as part of our educational series. We're happy to review those profiles with you. It's a great way to truly experience what the behavioral science products have to offer. So without further ado, also that we have our unlocking guide as the handout. That goes hand in hand with, if you're taking your profile or invite others to take theirs along with you, that unlocking guide goes a long way to discerning the various profiles and how they interact. It's all about the relationships within a team or within a business, or certainly with the financial advisors and their clients. And today's focus is going to be on that client couple. And without further ado, let's get on to it.
All right. Thank you, Tripp. Appreciate it. And looking forward to running through the material. As Tripp mentioned, this is a part three, and you didn't have to necessarily be part of one or two because we do sort of an overview, but the concentration will really be around couples and sort of volatility that, you know, the market would have or in a portfolio, and how advisors can actually work with both of the client couples, keep them both sort of really engaged in the financial planning process. I think it's one of my favorite topics to cover because I think it's, as Tripp mentioned, you know, behavioral science and using it sort of in a way that helps enable a client or a client couple can really be rewarding. And I talk with many advisors, truly not just in the U.S., but around the world, and using financial DNA can be one of those things that enables and really differentiates your practice from somebody else's. So we'll cover the financial behavior. We'll get in a little bit of depth on that. We'll cover the 10 unique styles. And as Tripp mentioned, there is an unlocking guide handout. Really encourage you to download that because that's really the key document around learning how to use financial DNA. Then we'll concentrate sort of on a couple of case studies around couples and sort of the differences between sort of how they would actually show up at a meeting. And then implementing a behavioral approach, which is really sort of how other advisors are using it. And so we cover that a little bit. And then if there are questions, Tripp did mention there's a chat box. Encourage you to do that. He sort of monitors that and answers questions as we go. We will actually pick up a question that may be informative to everybody that we try to share at the very end, but we'll keep it to about 35, 40 minutes. And without that, we'll get into the content. So in this particular slide, and I'm glad Tripp included this, we don't always have it in our deck, but it speaks to, you know, you as a financial advisor giving a lot of great information probably very little of it is actually understood by the client. And it's because sort of they see their lens of sort of their experiences and their what we call level one and level two behaviors sort of coming into play that they may not actually sort of understand anything that you've said. So it's sort of in a change management world, you know, sometimes you have to repeat things or show people six times before it's understood. Seems like a lot of energy spent, but, you know, if you really want to have a very sort of seamless experience with the client, sometimes it does require a little bit of the affirmative from the client that they do understand.
And I was just going to add, yeah, depending on the personality sitting across the table, they're going to pick up on one piece and not another, and you just may not be very adept at understanding or getting what they're picking up on. And then from the advisor standpoint, you know, what is the information that they're providing? Is it in a way that is best understood from the client's learning behavior and certainly a client couple when that gap in understanding between the two of them can be a barrier to understanding?
Yeah, absolutely. And since we're focused on couples today, you know, we do know, and believe me, I've talked with a number of firms around, sort of if there's a life change experience with the client couple or the family, sometimes that client will leave the firm. And, you know, you might be blindsided by that. And it really speaks to, you know, most of the time we see financial advisors concentrating on one of the clients because they're more of a match sort of behaviorally than the other client might have been or the other spouse. So it's very important for you as an advisor to really know how to build a relationship sort of based on that unique talent of both individuals. Lead the meetings really understanding the couple differences and create that customized experience and that commitment to their financial plan. It really speaks to the power of the behavioral intelligence that you have with financial DNA. And to that end, we do spend time talking about this 93.6% of financial planning is behavioral management. And every one of you on the call that sort of works with clients probably can speak to, there's a high percentage of time or energy spent around getting to know the client and sort of reacting. Sometimes it's more reactionary to the client's emotions, sometimes in volatile markets. You don't even know these things could happen. It speaks to that every client probably has a little bit of a different experience because of their behavior and that wiring. So it's rarely about the actual investment. As you can see here, 6.4% is really related to the investments. So that 93.6 is something that you have to manage. And Vanguard did a study back in 2015 around behavioral management of the client. And we're not, you know, sort of going to get into the details of that. But it really sort of supports what Mir Statman did that research back in 2000 on the 93.6%. So it's a great sort of supporting reason to using behavioral science in your practice. And with financial DNA, we sort of break the world up into three sort of components. The middle part is the financial personality of the client. But we measure things in financial DNA around risk profiling, the behavioral biases, and we measure 16 of them, and every one of us has an element of that in our profile. We also really help the advisor in the client communication. And as we talked earlier, even if the client couple is wired differently, meaning that they're on opposite spectrums, you can have a great client experience because you know how to use this information for a better outcome to the meeting and building the portfolio. And quite honestly, if you work with teams, it helps your team understand the clients at a deeper level as well. And then the goals and spending behavior sort of is measured. And one thing that I commonly hear is that, you know, if you have a client that's a big spender, you know, they spend a lot, you know, it's sort of a sort of keep that lifestyle image, you know, that can really derail a plan pretty quickly. And if you have the other spouse that's a saver, you can understand where there can be a lot of conflict or sort of resistance that might keep the plan from actually sort of meeting its goal. So that's what we measure with financial DNA. And we are just to get an understanding of the group, we're going to have a poll question here.
All right, everyone. So who among us is currently using a behavioral finance tool? And we'll allow some time for everyone to chime in and get a good cross-section of our followers here and share those results. So just under 50% Which is fine, and certainly understand that there's a lot of off-cuff ways of determining how to adapt your behavior and your communication to the other across the table, but sometimes the science brings you a bit more closer to the genuine article.
This is great. Almost, you know, it was almost 100% voted for this, so the 44% that does use something, that's commendable, and I know there are a lot of sort of different sort of approaches using behavioral insights. So the 56% that didn't, you know, you might be using something, but, you know, I think when you're working with teams, having something that's consistent and sustainable in the firm can really add to a lot of value and sort of really building the practice that's more sort of suited to your sort of life goals as well. Right. So in this particular example, we have a couple, and let's say that they're married, and you can see that during volatility in the market, that the same performance can cause one to be negatively reacting and the other to be sort of positively reacting. And we see this, and these behavioral biases sort of play into that. Now, you know, some people sort of ignore the market and they sort of trust their advisors leading them in the right sort of you know, keeping them sort of in their portfolio. But a lot of times, because of this behavioral bias we call herd mentality, and many of you probably have studied it, you know, with herd mentality, they may see the market or hear something on the news which might cause them to call the advisor. And that's where maybe it's sort of prompting a little bit more proactiveness around that market and sort of easing the fear of the one on the left and seeing it as an opportunity for the person on the right to invest. And I mentioned the value proposition around the Schwab, the Vanguard study that was done in 2015. It supports that 93.6% of financial planning. This is something that's probably very important to understand, because your value as a financial advisor, we do know that, you know, with investing, that it's sort of moved more to a commodity, you know, with support, do-it-yourself or DIY sort of sites to for individuals to select their own investing. You know, there's a bit of a danger in that, and not that the sites are dangerous, but that, you know, an individual that actually doesn't have another individual to sort of support or to bounce ideas of can really sort of, their behavioral biases can get in the way of their own sort of building wealth. But when you use a behavioral approach or some sort of behavioral sort of coaching, you can actually help the client deliver 150 basis points what they couldn't do themselves. And it makes sense, because if somebody is very hardwired, maybe in overconfidence in their behavioral bias, they may actually feel confident, they don't do the necessary research, but they invest and they have a loss. Where if they had an advisor that would sort of give them a little bit of a guidance and help them, you know, they could actually deliver sort of a higher percentage, and it really supports this 150 basis points. And you could use another case study with somebody that's a little bit more cautious in investing, and, you know, so you have to sort of show the value of that. The other thing that's, you know, intrinsically sort of an uplift is firm ROI value. When you use a behavioral approach, your clients feel much more sort of part of your firm, and actually would be more likely to refer you to one of their friends and family, which sort of increases sort of the wallet share of building your practice. So if you aren't familiar with that research, if you do a Google search, it's a great one to study. And, you know, many advisors use it because it really does show the differentiator of how you add value to that. And typically, you know, it offsets any fees that they would pay to the firm. So now we're going to get a little bit of the nuts and bolts around financial DNA. And we really start off by talking about this concept of level one and level two behaviors. And if any of you have studied Daniel Kahneman's work on thinking fast and slow, so the level one behavior is sort of underneath the iceberg, and it's really depicted by sort of this unconscious bias. We do make decisions sometimes. We don't even know why we make decisions, but we do. So it's sort of innate into us. And the natural behavior process is really something that is wired after you complete the 46 questions. sort of it pinpoints this natural behavior wiring that's sort of programmed by the time we're 3 years old. So it's very, very innate into who we are. But it measures things like automatic decision-making biases, our learning style, how we actually like to be sold to, and then sort of our communication preferences. It's very, very deep. And then things that are above the surface, or we call that, the iceberg itself, are things that are level two behaviors that Daniel Kahneman wrote about, level system two. It's really things that we've learned in our lifetime through maybe after sort of adolescence, adulthood. We continue to learn things, and it's sometimes referred to as emotional intelligence or EQ. The two of them make up sort of how we make decisions, but we really have much stronger preference, like 95% underneath sort of that iceberg. So it's very hardwired into who we are as individuals. And if you know that about yourself, you can have a much better idea of how you make better decisions, sort of how you work with an advisor, how you work with your spouse and sort of investing. It's something that's it's really sort of light bulb moments for some people to be able to go through this process. And the process itself takes about 10 to 12 minutes. So in our methodology of what we teach here at DNA Behavior is the know, engage, and grow principle. So a financial advisor who's getting to know their clients, and we all know there's a fiduciary duty, there's certainly moving in that direction around know your clients. You really know who the clients are, how you actually work with them. You develop sort of understanding of their communication style, how they think about goals, how they actually sort of think about investing. You can also have them complete sort of the full picture around their learned behavior, that level two that we talked about, so the full picture. And then the second phase of it is really engaging. So when you're actually working with your clients after you've gone through this know phase, is engaging with them to sort of work with them, building their portfolio sort of in their wealth planning, working with their family, their children. And then grow is really, sort of the consistency or the sustainability of working with the client. And then, when there are life-changing moments that are going on, whether they're retiring and they're thinking about buying, a property or whatever that is, helping them through that behavioral management lens of reframing it to make better decisions. And we measure sort of the, after somebody's completed natural behavior, we sort of look at it and after somebody's completed it and we, the individual will complete the assessment and then they'll see themselves or, they'll sort of be landing in somewhere in this chart we call the wheel or, it's a chart around how the 10 profiles work. And you can see at the very top of the influencer, it's somebody that's very fast paced, tends to be a little outgoing and makes decisions fairly quickly. The way that they make decisions may be difficult, and I say that maybe fast in making a decision, but they may not be as sort of have all the information. The people at the very bottom, starting with that adapter, are somebody that's actually very conscious of how they make decisions, so they're going to be a little more thoughtful. If you look over on the very direct left, somebody that's very results focused, maybe a reflective thinker or a strategist, they're going to be very sort of rational in their decision making. And the folks on the right, being the community builder, relationship builder, or sort of the polar opposites of that strategist, they think of the world through the lens of the relationship. So that's sort of the four quadrants that sort of make up, where an individual will land in their level one, that natural behavior. And it really helps to go through this process for yourself because you really see your unique talents, sort of where you are in this. And all of us have a unique set of patterns. So even though, Tripp and I are what we call an initiator over there in that top left-hand corner of that of the wheel, we have very different behavioral insights that sort of drive who we are. So even though you can approach us sort of in a way that sort of giving us options, sort of being quick and sort of the pace at which we deliver the information, we both have a unique set of patterns, and that's what's unique about it. Versus you look on the other side of it, and at the facilitator, I'll use that as an example. We have somebody on our team that is a facilitator on the bottom right-hand side, and that's someone that is very a little bit more cautious, but typically dots the I's and crosses the T's, pretty thoughtful in how they do things, a little more relational. So we can work great as team members, but quite honestly, if we don't really understand where we come from, we could really rub each other the wrong way. We could see our team members being, you know, a little bit sort of taking too long to make decisions, maybe needing more information than we would need. And that person might see us as being too fast-paced and maybe not buttoned up enough. That's sort of the differences in how this works. And then there's this compatibility matrix we use, sort of, and especially for new advisors getting comfortable with it. You can see there on the left, it's sort of the advisor on the axis and then the client on the top right, on the top center. And it shows the intensity that it takes to actually have pretty good communication and sort of being able to sort of have good outcomes. The more blue it is, more modification is needed. If it's light blue, that's minimal modification. So if you're actually an initiator, you're going to most of the time work pretty well with another initiator. It doesn't mean you have the same sort of decision-making style or the way you sort of think about the world, but you're going to probably be able to move through things pretty quickly. And then when you think about the quadrants, the more opposite you are, that it's farther away from your quadrant, it's more difficult and that more modification would be needed. And I think a lot of advisors like to use this because it does help them sort of size up when they're getting ready or prepared for meetings and helping them with outcomes, you know, even post-meeting. And then we do this formula. Our CEO sort of looks at this, sort of that level one, level two behavior we talked about. That in financial planning, you know, you think about sort of what you know about financial finances plus the money over emotion can really drive behavioral responses that are either rational or maybe irrational. So it's really, if you can do a better job as an advisor predicting, planning risks for your clients, you're going to be able to help that client make better decisions. And we do a webinar called Goals-Based Planning. Tripp and I've done that a number of times. And it really speaks to because everybody's trying to meet their goals, the sheer nature of some profiles, like the facilitator, when you actually use the term goals, it sort of turns them off. It makes it uncomfortable. So there's, you know, just the terminology can sometimes drive sort of decision-making that may not be productive. So that's what we really try to teach with financial data and understanding and be more proactive with your clients. And just to sort of even break it down to another level, the natural behavior process, we call it a forced choice assessment model. And if anybody's familiar with how the big five assessment models are created, you know, they're all based on sort of a similar methodology that all have differences. Ours is a forced choice model, meaning that you have to choose one most and one least, and it does it in a 46 question discovery, moves pretty fast, takes about 10 minutes, 10 to 12 minutes is average. And at the end of it, you will get sort of a report, because we're always about learning something. You know, we're really advocates of delivering the information to the client, not necessarily holding that back, because it's a journey for them to learn. But after somebody's completed that, it really does measure some very deep insights that are very powerful. You can really help a client with some major discovery of themselves or the couple client. And it gives, at the end of the process, it gives sort of a client dashboard that gives an opportunity to see a self-guided video of their own profile type, some information on sort of their styles and their behavioral biases. And one of the reports that we delivered back at the beginning of this year is what we call a financial behavior report. And it's a one-page summary of, after somebody's completed the questionnaire, of their sort of behavioral, a lot of key information for an advisor to use. But this is the deliverable report that the client would receive. And in the report, it would show their financial behavior, it'll show their profile type and where they are on the wheel. There are two top behavioral factors. We do measure 16 of them, but you know, we really key in on the two top behavioral factors because they usually sort of drive a lot of that behavior. We also show the client's financial behavior, client's comfort zone, and then the five elements of sort of risk and how they think about financial planning. And it's disclosed there. You can see it may not be easy to read, but starts out with risk behavior, then how well, and the second one, financial management relationship. Third one is financial planning, how they actually will plan, sort of, you know, actually bringing information to the meeting. Then their wealth building motivation is the fourth one. And then the fifth one is their financial emotional intelligence. You know, how would they react to volatility in the market? It's a great one-page report. Advisors really like it. Some of them actually use it in the meeting with the client. There's some deeper insights that you would be able to get sort of with other reports, but this is sort of a staple now as part of that completion process. And some things to remember that you'd really want to use, and our advice always with a new advisor is, if you actually have friends and family that you have go through this process called financial DNA, you really learn pretty quickly how this works because you know that person so intimately. It makes it much easier when you actually start using clients. But some very key points to remember here, that it measures this hardwired behavior. Some people might challenge and say, you know, well, it's not exactly me, but in the core of who they are, we always get it, you know, encourage somebody to share it with their spouse, which really does help validate it, because it is really who you are. It's just making sure that you so recognize there's a level one behavior, and then that level two behavior, that sort of the emotional intelligence. We don't identify baggage or mental health issues. It's not what DNA behavior does. The behavioral traits will remain consistent over time, very stable. You take it today, if you're 18, if you're 90 and take it, you'll have very similar sort of results. There's no good or bad style. I've worked with, out of all 10 profiles, I've worked with somebody from every style. Shouldn't be used to box or to label people, because we all have a unique set of behavioral insights, but you really want to know sort of where people are. It helps expedite and sort of enhance the relationship. No decision should be solely made on the report, the data point. You should always remember that. Great advisors do and have come from all different behavioral styles. I do see common trends around people building practices that more in their quadrant than complete opposite. And then the behavioral factors are really sort of neutral to gender, age, generation, and birth order. It's very important to know that. And we do continuous research on that. And just to see how everybody sort of understands it, we have another poll question here.
Yes, keep everybody moving forward. So do you understand how behavioral biases impact investor and advisor decision making? And we'll get a quick cross section of answers here. And wow, we're getting some great responses, which is fantastic. So thank you. And they're all very positive.
Right.
So
that's a really high percentage of that completed it. So 100%, you can't get better than that. So, and I'm sure in the field of study with financial planning that you've all studied behavioral biases. This can be really key, knowing those behavioral biases and how to actually be that behavioral coach with your clients. And this is a case study we call Chris and Helen. Chris is what we call a strategist, and that's somebody that's, if you'll remember from that original chart showing the 10 profiles, he sits there very sort of results focused, not necessarily real relational, and right in the center on information need. So Chris has sort of a profile that's what we call would be pretty high risk. He's a risk taker. He also has very low financial relationship management, meaning that he is somebody that is not going to be necessarily comfortable to engage with the advisor. It's going to take a little bit of time and effort for him to engage with the advisor. Helen, his wife, is an engager. They're still both, you know, high at the top of sort of, on fast-paced. But she also has this very high financial emotional intelligence and low relationship management as well. So they sort of have that in them that's going to be more difficult for the advisor connecting with the client, because they tend to be more self-sufficient. So, you know, that they've got a lot of high scores, it might seem that they might be more of a do-it-yourself sort of couple, but again, it gets back to that value proposition of that 150 basis points. If you're working with both of them, you as an advisor can really help them with sort of maybe stepping back and looking at the long-term sort of implications of a profile. So it's lots of opportunities with somebody like Chris and Helen to insert yourself to help them, even though that it might appear that they're pretty self-sufficient. Again, those behavioral biases, overconfidence, maybe looking at a consolidated view might be kicking in for the clients that, you know, they might not realize they actually need that advisor. So there's always opportunity, and I think this is a good case study. Shows the two clients. What I would say about this potential report for the two of them is they're pretty closely matched in their behavioral sort of, in their behavior report. This is the comparison report of both of them. Usually when you see high scores and a low score for the client couple, that's where you're going to have some angst typically, or you're probably going to have to probe a little bit. So it's quite interesting. Chris, if you do see that in the number two one, he's a 33 on sort of actually working with an advisor. That's pretty low. Helen's at 50. So your work is convincing them sort of that there's a lot of value there working with the advisor. You see somebody that scores a 70 or 80, you know, it's much easier to sort of get them in the boat and they see the value of using a financial advisor. And this is just another report. We call it the one-page talent report for the couple. And this is a case study with Frank and Mary Butler. And they're both different profiles than Chris and Helen. And that Frank is what we call an initiator. Again, somebody that's pretty high risk-taking. He's actually a group profile six. So he's at 92% of actually taking risks. So, you know, that's a pretty big risk-taker. With his wife being at 16, she's a group two because she's a community builder. And so the challenge of working with somebody like Frank and Mary would be that he's going to want to take the risks. She's going to want to be more apprehensive or conservative, you know, for the family. And so you can see here in this report that he's indicated by the lighter blue. She's indicated by the darker blue. You can see there's a lot of differences between the two of them. And at the very bottom of that chart, you can see where may take control of decision making. Chris or Frank scores at a 79 and delegates to the advisor on the opposite side is Mary, who's, you know, very high percentage at 69%, 59. So it's very high percentage where she's going to be more comfortable to delegate to the advisor. So if you're meeting with the two of them, there's more likelihood that you're going to connect with Mary because she's going to be a little bit more, you know, sort of engaging than Frank would be. But if you're also an initiator, and like Frank, you may actually spend more time with him and sort of, she doesn't even feel part of the meeting. So there's very subtle things you can do in these couple conversations to help sort of keep both of them sort of in agreement on what you're building, make sure that you're sort of communicating with both of them that they do understand. It gets back to that comic slide that we started at the very beginning. You're saying things, but one of them might not even hear it, and more likely it would be Mary if you're an initiator. If you're a community builder like Mary, Frank might tune you out. So it's very, you know, that advisor-client compatibility matrix. It's a good, opportunity to review that prior to the meeting, knowing who you're going into that meeting with.
Yeah, I think it's good to point out that certainly the statistics are still there out there that at least in marriage or at least a first marriage that the couples still tend to be at a high 70% plus rate to be opposites. And you don't find until someone's, you know, if for the marriages that don't work out for that 50% divorce rate, that those remarriages is when a couple or individual finds that significant other than is a bit more in line with themselves. So that those little nuances, it might be a stereotype, but the nuances within those and the insights within a reporting of this type help to be able to connect to both and also identify where you stand within that connection so that the communication and the understanding of building that portfolio, building that relationship, the foundation of it is built upon the transparency and the knowledge amongst everybody involved.
Very good point. So the next, so we covered the case studies around those couple client meetings. you know, there's a tool we call Market Mood, which is now part of our retail package for every package. It gives individual guidance in a volatile market. So not that you would call your client and say, I see your market mood is apprehensive, but it gives the advisor some tools to be able to know what to communicate with the client based on their specific behavioral insights here. And that's probably a huge advantage. It doesn't mean that you would sort of call the client, you know, maybe if they haven't called you, but if you're getting ready to have a conversation with your client, it's always a good idea to check with this, sort of give you a tip on sort of what their behavioral makeup is, and it just helps enable the conversation when you do need to call them.
Yeah, those scripts and those social cues, those communication cues that can help you characterize or set up your engagement for them, or if they've reached out to you, so you can best manage them to, you know, stick to the plan, stick to the portfolio, realize the goal is much better or bigger than the immediate market swing.
Exactly. Very good point. Have another poll question as we're getting ready to close.
So as we finish up here, so can you as an advisor use behavioral finance to understand client personalities and to help them achieve their goals? We'll make this one quick and easy for everyone. And again, I think, Leon, you've done real well with keeping everybody on point.
Very good. I think that's one of our highest percentages. So thank you all for appeasing us.
And a high percentage of participants, too. Not bad.
Great. One of the things that we always try to do in our webinars is sort of showcase the next webinar series that comes in. We do work with a number of firms that, you know, those are smaller firms that, you know, use sort of a team-based approach. And a lot of times you are building your team or, you know, your sort of your practice. So our featured webinar is going to be around the Master Key Executive. It's sort of the number two person in the firm that you really can help leverage using natural behavior that we've covered today, sort of being much more complementary around sort of the work that you do in the second person. So it's going to be a great webinar around talent management. So encourage you to register for that. The registration page is there. It's actually on our website, and Tripp has included it here. You will get the PDF of this presentation at the end of the call and shortly afterwards. So you can click on that to register for that webinar.
If I didn't stress earlier that everything is being recorded, a link to that recording will be provided once everything's wrapped up, so you can review that on your own, as well as the PDF of the deck and the unlocking guide is still there, and the opportunity to take your own profile, all that is available.
And that's where you can find out more. If you go to financialdna.com, there's actually a button there that you can actually take your profile.
Take your own demo. Mm-hmm.
We encourage you to do that. Our contact information is here. We continue to update our blog. I think Tripp's team probably publishes 1 to 2 a month. So great content. We also have a podcast channel on iTunes, and it's just a click here around connecting. And there are very 17 to 19 minutes of sort of behavioral finance topics. And building teams. And then there's always the Financial DNA Resource Center there that gives not only just internal information that we create, but external articles that are very relevant to sort of building behaviorally smart.
And the articles, webinars such as this, there are other recordings that are available depending on the teachings and interest on your end. Videos that we produce as part of our educational series posted on our YouTube page, DNA Behavior. So all of those resources are made readily available to our followers.
And with that, I also wanted to draw your attention that there's a great appendix here with a lot of great information that you can look at after we've sent out that PDF. We don't have time to cover it today, but in the interest of time, we tried to keep it to 40 minutes, which I think we did a good job today. So really appreciate everybody's participation. Always enjoy seeing sort of second timers come to the webinar, and even the new timers. Thank you very much. We really appreciate it. And if you have questions, you know, please direct them to us. That survey that Tripp mentioned gets dispatched shortly after this webinar. We look at that information to build our next webinar series. So please take the time to fill that out.
Thank you very much, everyone. Enjoy the rest of your day.